1:01 or thereabouts, and I call the 2020 annual town meeting to order. I am Dan McKinley. I'm your moderator, town moderator, moderator for the past year, and I'll serve moderator until at least the first article, and then we'll see what happens. I'd like to start us out with the Pledge of Allegiance. If you're able to stand and join us, down on your heads. Pledge of Allegiance.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Nicely done. So the town meeting, as you know, is governed by state law and Robert's Rules of Order. I'd like to remind you of some of those general Robert's Rules to make this go a little bit smoother for both the season's town meeting goers and the new folks that may not be as up to speed on Robert's Rules. You may speak twice on any article, first time when you're recognized by the moderator. And then you may speak a second time if everyone that wishes to speak once has had their chance. You may speak for 5 minutes at a time, a total of 10 minutes. The business that we're here to conduct is on pages 2, 3, and 5 in your town plan. If you do wish to speak, please stand if you are able. And we do not have microphones to run this evening. Unfortunately, they haven't woken up since last town meeting. And they're up here just sort of dormant. So you're really going to need to project your voice. And if you can, you're technically supposed to address the moderator, but if you can turn and talk to folks and project your voice, it'll help a lot. For non-election articles, we'll attempt to decide by voice vote, but you may request a division of the House, which means a showing of hands or a rising, if you do not like the way the voice vote sounds or if you'd like to be more accurate. Similarly, a paper ballot can be requested by 7 voters, and we would do that. But really know that there are some of the officers are elected by paper ballot. Remember that to cut off debate or call the question, you must be recognized before you do that. You can't just shout out, call the question. You got to wait until your turn. There may be several people ahead of you, but when it comes to your turn, you can call the question. And it takes 2/3 vote to end debate. And if we get 2/3 of a vote, we'll end the debate and we'll vote on the on the table. If we don't get 2/3 vote, we'll continue the debate. It's up to you. Speeches must be confined to the merit of the question at hand. You will not be permitted to attack the person or the motives of the person. Please keep your comments to the merit of the question. Only warrant articles may be considered. Binding action cannot be taken under the article of other business. The role of the moderator is to help you accomplish your business expeditiously and fairly. Please raise your hand and I'll recognize you in the order I see you. I'll try to call you by name, but I may not know you, or I may know you for 30 years and forget your name. But I might have to say, hey, you, so bear with me, please. And again, use your best outside voice. The moderator's ruling can be appealed. I want to remind you of that, and I encourage you to do so if you think I'm not following the rules. I'm really here to follow the will of the assembly, so I won't be offended if you want to appeal my decision I make. You don't have to be recognized. Have your hand up and recognized if you want to appeal. That one you can just shout out. Say you don't want to appeal a ruling. And I would explain my ruling. If there's a second to the appeal, I'll explain my ruling, and then we'll vote to sustain my ruling or not. If you think I'm violating Robert's Rules of Order, which very well may be, you can also call out point of order, and we'll discuss that and consider whether I'm in the ballpark. The moderator can use unanimous consent, and that just allows us to move things along. And like when I say if there are no objections, that means we'll skip a step or two, like closing the nominations or allowing a person a third time to speak, something like that. So I'll say if there are no objections, that means I'm skating around some rules. And if you don't want me to do that, you say no, I object to you to that, and that's perfectly fine to do so. Robert's Rules does not allow for reading from papers or reading a book or an article or paper, but that rule can be suspended. So if you rise and plan to speak or read from papers, just let us know and we'll say if there are no objections, we'll let Jane Doe read from papers. At this time, I would ask that those that are not registered voters, please raise your hand or make yourself known. Okay. Thank you and welcome. It's been our practice to allow non-registered voters to speak at our meetings. And I would use unanimous consent here and say, if there are no objections, we'll let our visitors speak this evening. Very well, thank you. But please, you can't vote. You know, you might get in the heat of the moment, throw your hand up about something, but keep your hand down. At this time, I believe there's no opening remarks from the select board at this time, but I will invite dignitaries. Oh, look, Representative Haas is in the front row. Would you like to say something?
So, as usual, when I come to you this time of year, we are at that point in the legislative session when we're just about ready to drop a fence and say that any bill that has not come out of committee is dead for not only for the year but for the biennium. This is that we are in a two-term biennium, and this is the end. So we have one, we're off this week for a town meeting. We go back and we have one more week to vote our bills out of committee and get them on their way to the other body. So any House bill that hasn't come out of committee by next Friday is finished, and any Senate bill the same. And then we'll spend the last 2 months or so looking at the bills that have come over to us from the other body. The big news, a lot of it you've heard, we did pass the minimum wage. We overrode the veto last week, and so the minimum wage, which is currently $10.96, will go to $11.75 next January, and on January 1st of 2022, it will go to $12.55. And at that point, unless there's another bill in next year, it will then go back to the consumer price index increases that we've been seeing this last time. I think it was 19 cents from last year to this year. So that's what the CPI does. Major issues this year, we really have decided that it is time to take some action to address climate change. And we're trying to be careful about that, judicious. We have something called a Climate Solutions Caucus that meets every week. And I think there are 87 of us between the two bodies who are members of that and come pretty regularly to those meetings. The House just passed last week the Global Warming Solutions Act, which basically will put into statute the carbon reduction goals that have been part of the state vision, part of the state plan for several years, but they weren't in statute. So this puts them into statute, and it creates a council to look at them. Out on the front table, I have a written report that has a little bit more about that bill. That obviously moves to the Senate. We're hoping they won't tinker with it too much, but they probably will do something different. I want to remind you about the census. You're just about to get something in the mail on that. The census folks are, because of all the publicity last year, they are very nervous about what's called a complete count. I met with a member of one of their employees this summer, and apparently the town of Goshen participated so little that they got, that only half of their citizens got counted. It's important because it affects the money that comes to us from the federal government. When we do our budget every year, nearly, I think about $2 billion of what we spend in Vermont is money that comes to us from the federal government, whether it's for highways, for subsidies for childcare, for work that's done by the health department, which is going to be very important now. All of this, we rely very heavily on support from the federal government, and much of that is tied to knowing how many people we are. So please, when you get it, you can do it by mail, you can do it online, you can do it by phone. If they don't hear from you on the first try, they will try again. But please do it, and please encourage your friends and neighbors to participate. It's really important that we do that. I think it's also, I also want to just let you know that the health department is really gearing up to address the steps that Vermont is going to take to address the coronavirus. We're hearing a lot about that in the news. So if you go to the Vermont Department of Health website, it's right there at the very top of their website, and there are links to what you can do, what physicians can do, and they'll have all of the latest updates on steps that they're taking. And I think with that, I will say enjoy the meeting. I'll be in town all week. If you have questions or concerns for me, it's good to see you.
Okay, we'll move to the warning and the business at hand this evening. The warning reads, the town of Rochester, Vermont's annual town meeting to be held Monday, March 2nd, 2020. At 7 p.m., the legal voters of the town of Rochester, County of Windsor, State of Vermont, are hereby warned and notified to meet at the Rochester School Auditorium in said town on Monday, March 2nd, 2020 at 7 p.m. to transact the following business from the floor. Technically, I should read the warning, but I think it would be happy not to. If there are no objections, I will not read the entire warning, but we will go through it article by article. No objections.
Can you read it? Read the warning, please.
Read the entire warning.
I'm being warned, and I need warnings.
Do I need a second on that? I'm asking to suspend the rules, and there's an objection. I would accept the motion to suspend the rules. That would need a second and a two-third vote. But if the gentleman would like me to read the entire warning, I will do so if there is not a motion to suspend that.
Motion to suspend.
Second.
Seconded. Motion to suspend the rule to read the warning, and it's been seconded. And I need a two-thirds vote to suspend that rule. All in favor of suspending that rule, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say nay. Thank you.
Question, where can we find the warning after this meeting?
Right here.
The warning is in the town plan. Town report. Does anyone have? Is there an extra one that we could give John?
If you're a registered voter, you would have gotten one in the mail.
Anybody have an extra one? I'm sorry to leave you out by not having.
Here's an extra.
There we go. Hey, we got an extra one for you here.
It's available online as well.
Back row.
Thank you. Thanks, Becky. So we'll move to Article 1. Article 1, to elect the town moderator for the ensuing year. Nominations?
Nominate Dan McKinley.
Dan McKinley's been nominated.
I'll second it.
Seconded. Any other nominations? Close nominations and ask the clerk to cast one vote for Dan McKinley as town moderator. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan.
We know it's not always clear that it's a sign of a good job, it's just someone else not wanting to do it. Article 2, to elect all town officers as required by law. 1, the select board 3-year term. 2, town clerk 1-year term. 3, town treasurer 1-year term. 4, lister 3-year term. 5, collector of delinquent taxes 1-year term. Library trustee 5-year term. Number 7, trustee of public lands. Number 8, cemetery commissioner. Number 9, cemetery commissioner for 4-year term. The other was a 5-year term. Number 10, agent to prosecute and defend suits, 1-year term. Number 11, agent to convey real estate. Starting off with number 1, the select board position for a 3-year term. Nominations. Nancy?
Mr. Moderator, I'd like to nominate Frank Severy. Frank has been a lifelong resident of the town of Rochester and has been quite active in town affairs. He spent many years on the planning board.
Seconded by Harlan. Any other nominations? Hearing none, we will close nominations. Wait, where's Frank? Does Frank want to do this? Or?
Right here.
He's still smiling.
Yeah. And we'll ask the clerk to cast one vote. One ballot for Frank Savory, and thank you for offering to serve, Frank. Appreciate it.
So, you didn't mention who is Frank is replacing, and that would be Tom here, and we'd like to thank Tom for his 3 years of service on the board, and I don't know if you have any parting words of wisdom for us, but thank you for all the projects you've taken on and your contributions over the years.
I appreciate it.
Number 2, to elect a town clerk for a 1-year term, currently held by Julie Smith.
Nominate Julie Smith.
Julie Smith has been nominated. Second. Julie's been the second. Any other nominations for town clerk? Hearing none, close nominations. We'll ask the clerk to cast a ballot for herself. Wonderful. Thank you, George. Number 3, to elect a town treasurer, 1-year term, also held by Julie Smith. Nominations.
Nominate Julie Smith.
Julie Smith's been nominated.
Seconded.
Any other nominations for town treasurer? Hearing none, I ask the clerk to cast one vote for Julie Smith for town treasurer. Thank you, Julie. Number 4, lister, a 3-year term position held by Louis Gonet. How many years, Louis, were you lister?
A lot.
A lot of years.
Over 30.
Thank you for your service. Nominations for lister, 3-year term. Louis's been nominated and seconded. Any other nominations? No other nominations. We'll close nominations. Ask the clerk to cast one ballot for Louis Gonet, our lister, for a 3-year term. Thank you, Lister. Thank you, Louis. Number 5, collector of delinquent taxes for a 1-year term, currently held by Becky Klein. Nominations, please.
I nominate
Becky. Becky's been nominated.
Seconded.
Any other nominations for collector of delinquent taxes? Hearing none, we'll close nominations. And ask the clerk to cast one ballot for Becky Klein for collector of delinquent taxes, 1-year term. Thank you, Becky. Number 6, library trustee, a 5-year term, currently held by Tony Gupton.
I nominate Tony Gupton. nominate Tony Goopy.
Tony Goopy's been nominated. Seconded. Any other nominations? Hearing none, ask the clerk to cast one ballot for Tony Goopy for library trustee in a 5-year term. Number 7, trustee of public lands, a 3-year term.
Funds.
Public funds.
Yes, yes, funds.
Lands, funds.
Trustee of public funds for a 3-year term, held by Mike Carty. Clerk, nomination?
Mike Carty.
Mike Carty's been nominated.
Seconded.
Any other nominations? Hearing none, close nominations, and ask clerk to cast one ballot for a trustee of public funds for a 3-year term, Mike Carty. Thank you, Mike. Verdict, a cemetery commissioner, a 5-year term currently held by Marvin Hardy.
I can nominate Marv Hardy.
Marv Hardy's been nominated. Second.
Seconded.
Any other nominations? Close nominations and ask the clerk to cast one ballot for cemetery commissioner for a 5-year term for Marvin Hardy. Thank you, Marvin.
All right, Marvin.
We're now a cemetery commissioner for a 4-year term, which is currently vacant. Any nominations?
I'd like to nominate Nancy Woolley.
Nancy Woolley's been nominated.
Seconded.
Any other nominations? Hearing none, we'll close nominations. We'll ask the clerk to cast one ballot for cemetery commissioner, 4-year term, to Nancy Woolley. Thank you, Nancy. Number 10, an agent to prosecute and defend suits, a 1-year term, held by Bill Matthews. Nominations?
I'd like to nominate Bill Matthews.
Bill Matthews has been nominated. Surprise, surprise. Seconded. Is Bill here?
Yes, I am.
Okay, great. Any other nominations? Hearing none, close nominations. Ask the clerk to cast one ballot for Bill Matthews for the agent to prosecute and defend suits for 1 year. Thank you, Bill.
Thank you, Bill.
And finally, last officer to be elected, number 11, agent to convey real estate, a 1-year term, held by Pat Hardy. Nominations, please.
Pat Hardy.
Pat Hardy's been nominated.
Second.
Seconded. Any other nominations? Hearing none, we'll close nominations and ask the clerk to cast one ballot for Pat Hardy for agent to convey real estate for a 1-year term. Thank you, Pat.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Article 3, to hear and act on the report of the auditors. Want to move this article?
We'll move.
Seconded.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? Report of the auditors. Hearing none, we'll move to a vote to accept the report of the auditors. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say nay. Not really sure what we do with that if like there was a, anyone said nay, but it's a report. Article 4, your article passes. Article 4, to hear and act on the reports of the town officers. Move this. Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Report of the town officers. Hearing none, we'll move to close discussion and move to a vote. All in favor of accepting the reports of the town officers, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say nay. Article 4 passes. Article 5, shall the voters agree to pay all taxes for fiscal year July 1, 2020 to June 30, 2021, fiscal year 21, to the town treasurer as provided by law? Approved. Seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, we'll move to a vote. Shall the voters agree to pay all taxes for fiscal year July 1, 2020 to June 30, 2021, FY21, to the town treasurer as provided by law? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say nay. Ayes have it. Article 5
I really refuse that one.
Article 6. Article 6, shall the voters authorize payment of real and personal property taxes in four installments, with two dates being Friday, August 14, 2020, Monday, November 16, 2020, Tuesday, February 16, 2021, and Monday, May 17, 2021, by delivery to the tax collector before 4 p.m. on those dates. Postmarks are not considered timely payment. Someone like to move it? Moved? Seconded? Seconded. Discussion? Hearing none. Close debate. If there are no objections, I will not repeat that. Then we'll go to a vote. For Article 6, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say nay. Ayes have it. Article 6 passes. Article 7, shall the voters authorize the total fund expenditures for operating expenses of $1,088,700, of which $780,550 shall be raised by taxes. Move and second. You want to move this article?
So moved.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? Yes, Louis.
I'm wondering if we, well, as I understand it, please correct me if I'm wrong, that we're this year, in an effort to rein in the taxes, are not funding the funds. Do I understand that correctly?
Not funding the reserve funds. Is that what you're, yeah, yes, that is right.
Go ahead, Louis, doesn't look like anyone else.
I'm just curious, going forward, what the idea is. What's the plan? I understand where this came from way back when and where we got to where we are now, but I'm just curious how we move this forward.
Well, there's definitely, this was kind of a bump in the expenses, so this was an effort to kind of not respond to highs and lows of the expenses. But that said, this has been a vehicle we've used in the past few years, bit by bit, to try and keep the budget in a moderate rise. So this, we're hoping to bring some of those reserve funds back. But there's also thoughts that perhaps instead of putting money away every year to save for a new truck, and then why not go and finance a new truck and use the money. You know, that way when you finance a new vehicle, the people that are paying for it, paying for that finance charge, are the people that are actually using it versus people paying for it now, a truck that will be bought in the future. This is one philosophy about it, because municipally we're eligible for really good low interest rates, and the interest that we get on money just sitting in the bank is not that good. So that's part of the philosophical discussion that is hovered around that decision. You want to say anything?
Also, leasing, it opens up the possibility of. It also opens up the possibility of leasing equipment instead of purchasing equipment. We're not saying that we're going in that direction. We're just opening up the possibility of it in the future.
Sorry, but the mic's not really projecting out.
Say that all over again.
The select board mics. Yeah.
All right.
Try another microphone.
Try another mic? Or just talk louder. There you go.
Hold it close.
Okay. Eat the mic.
Thank you. Do you need to repeat that?
No.
Okay.
Good thing.
Yes, John.
Out of curiosity, what is the fund used, very briefly, what's the fund used for? Is it like an emergency fund, or is it just?
There are several reserve funds. There would be like the fire equipment reserve fund and the highway equipment reserve fund. There is a reserve fund for maintenance of the tennis courts. There's a list of them on page 17. Total?
They're all totaled individually.
They're all...
Normally be funded.
Don't have a...
That number varied. It varied from year to year sometimes, so...
Talk to the microphone.
Yeah, I'm speaking.
The number that was placed in reserves varied from year to year, depending on the budget and how much we were, felt we were able to put into each reserve fund.
All right, so if the voters of Rochester wanted to vote that, vote extra money to cover the reserve fund this year, how much was not being funded this year because you wanted to keep the budget lower?
We would have to go back a couple years to come to that number.
I don't know if there's a, I can give you immediately a number. I mean, we could go back and get a pencil and add it up, but it's on page 17, it shows the history of what those are. You can go, I don't have that answer right off the bat.
Can you give us a ballpark number?
A ballpark?
500,000, 200,000?
Much less than that. we're talking probably, Nancy, you worked on the...
I think it's around 100.
Around 100?
100,000, okay.
Yeah, 100.
Brenda?
It seems to me that there's a possibility that it makes sense that you don't have a reserve fund for a vehicle because you can purchase a new vehicle, get a loan, et cetera. But some of the things that you are not reserving for, like, for instance, general maintenance of buildings or tennis court maintenance, I don't understand the rationale behind that. So an explanation.
I guess the main rationale for that is the taxes and to keep them. When we started the process at the budget committee, we're looking at a 22% increase in the taxes, which would probably be turned down at this meeting. We're thinking we struggled to get it down to just over a 4% increase in the tax rate. So that's basically the rationale, is to present a budget that's acceptable and is not going to be shocking. And it's a struggle. We spent way a lot of time debating all these questions.
I got a question on that.
Hang on a second. Can you folks want to remind you to raise your hand? We recognize you have one chance to speak already. I'm going to see who else, and then I'll come back to you.
Can I get a follow-up to that?
A follow-up question to you? Go ahead.
But you are saving money this year.
Can you stand up?
The select board has decided to save money this year, but what is the implication in 3 years when you have five buildings and a tennis court that need repair, need to be taken care of? It seems to me that you're going to spend money or spend money. You know, maybe you, I don't know exactly how much was decided for each particular venue that you were dealing with, but it seems to me to absolutely not fund at all seems foolhardy with money.
I just want to say his numbers don't add up. He says you set the budget at 22% increase, and you didn't want to deal with that because we would reject it. So you get it down to 4%. But that 18% is equivalent to $100,000. That doesn't make any sense at all.
No, the cutting of the reserve funds is only a portion of the manipulations that we did to come up with the whole budget. That doesn't represent the whole amount.
So we could put this back, and it wouldn't amount to very much then, right? In percentages.
About 5%.
Nancy, do you have a number on that?
I think it's about 1 cent for $9,000 or $10,000. And Greg White could probably answer it more succinctly.
That's close. 1 penny per $10,000 increase in the budget.
So it'd be about 10 cents.
On the tax rate?
Yeah, per 1,000.
And that...
Okay.
10 cents for 100.
So, can someone explain that? Greg, can you explain what that means? You might have to stand up and.
Yeah. What it means is, for every $10,000 increase in the budget, that price per 100, so it'd be it's a penny per hundred and multiply it by 10 to get whatever it is per thousand, and you go from there.
So your tax rate is based on 1,000?
Yeah, that's on the valuation of the property.
Go ahead, David.
Could the select board please explain some of the other, what you call manipulations that were done to the budget to keep it from increasing to 22%, so we can put this reserve fund unfunded, we can put it in perspective. What else did you unfund?
Folks, hear the comments, questions in the back. The question was, what else, what other funding changes were made to get to that 22% in addition to the reserve funds?
Yes,
I
paid off the loader, we knocked that down.
Well, one was we used some of the existing reserve fund to pay off the balance due on the loader. So therefore, that is not a loan payment that is going to come be paid in the next year. And so that was a big one. That was like $18,000-$20,000. The constable expense has gone down by removing our law enforcement constable and hiring the Windsor County Sheriff to cover that. What else? Lots of little bits and pieces here and there, but it's like we're shaving away. It's a challenge. Anything come to mind, anyone on the budget committee that I'd like to speak up about that?
I would say also that when these cuts were made, they were discussed with their department heads, and they felt that they could work within it.
So the reserve as an advocate only
hey, David.
Citizens of Rochester.
Excuse me, David, can you wait to be recognized, please? I had a hand up back here. Go ahead, Ethan.
Ethan Bowen. I just don't think you quite answered Brenda's question about if you're not funding some of these things, because obviously your lease and the loader or, you know, things like that, that makes sense to me. Not funding building funds and things like that. Is that pushing the money to sometime later where we may have a bigger expense?
It is pushing it later, but there were also some spikes in expenses that came this year that we are reacting to that we don't expect to have to deal with next year. So we do plan to. For example, legal expenses were significantly higher than what we're historically used to. We also had some employee benefit increases just by virtue of choices made by employees. And, it goes on and on. But those are a couple of the big ones. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah.
Yes, Jeff.
I would point out, I guess, that there is a balance in most of these funds at the moment in that you're talking about not depositing toward this coming fiscal
right.
year.
Right. Yeah, it's not like
we didn't drain
used it all up.
Jeff
was pointing out that there are some balances in these funds, so it's not like we eliminated the fund. There is still money that has been put in there over the years. We just couldn't afford to put more in this year.
David, did you want to add something? Okay. Any other discussion before we move to it? Yes, in the back. Rachel?
Yeah, I have a quick question. I'd like to know if there's an answer to the fellow's question in the front. What's the plan? A couple months ago at the town plan public hearing, there were three suggestions for new committees that could support the select board. I'd like to know if the select board's made a decision about whether or not there's going to be the addition of a conservation committee, an energy committee, and an economic development committee. Which could help supplement our revenue in town.
There is definitely movement towards having the energy committee, and there's actually a Quinn Town movement in that direction between the valleys. In terms of a conservation committee, I have not heard of any activity in that direction, and the, and what was the last, economic?
Economic Development Committee to come up with ideas to create revenue to support the budget committee.
In terms of an Economic Development Committee, there is, I would think the Envision Rochester initiative has been taking some dramatic, proactive steps in that direction, and that's
that,
been...
That's an independent group, so my question is, what is the Select Board doing that could have a committee that's appointed by the Select Board and therefore accountable to us and to the Select Board?
That's the budget and finance.
Has the revised town plan been adopted yet by the Select Board?
It's been encouraged, it's still under... under development, yeah. We've had the first meeting, but it's
so
not...
The Planning Commission has revised it, but you're waiting for a hearing on the town plan
right.
before the Select Board adopts it.
For the town plan, yeah.
Town plan, yeah.
But in terms of the town doing economic development, that is not a committee that is currently been banging on our doors asking to do work. I guess it's... you're saying that it was presented at the meeting as an option, but presenting options for that is helpful if it has volunteers to join and to carry those options.
So
if that makes sense.
Just as a follow-up, so we have a budget committee that's carving up our tax budget, our
finance
taxes now, but from what I understand, there's no committee focused on coming up with ideas to generate revenue. So as our expenses go up, what's the plan?
More taxes.
More taxes, more efficient taxes. You know, it would be great to have some volunteer grant writers out there in the crowd.
I suggest,
you with your hand up back here.
In other nations, other sovereign countries, they tax profits. So if you end the year with a certain amount more than you began the year with, those profits are taxed. And when you speak of grants, many companies that give out grants or write for grants are actually multi-billion dollar companies in the first place. So if we were to begin taxing profits, the companies that generally garner the most profit are the ones that are using most infrastructure and delegating the most tasks to be done.
Yeah.
And it frees up the working man's pockets, so that way more of the dollar they earn ends up directly into their pocket, and less of it feeling like so much of it is already taken away before they ever receive anything in the first place.
Can we stick
John,
to the question?
John?
Yeah. Like to point out, probably under state law, we can't do that anyway. And none of these billion-dollar corporations happen to have any headquarters in Rochester.
Not yet.
Need to get working on that.
We're talking about budgets.
I think the discussion is to remain the people have thought about how to raise funds. Ethan, did you have another comment?
Are we working on a specific amendment here?
We are not.
A dollar amount, so I'm just sort of...
There's no amendment. There's people making comments on the budget and how it's we're trying to make more money. Martha and Chris mentioned Martha.
I just want to call the question if possible.
Okay. Steve, call the question. The question's been called to end debate. All in favor of ending debate, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say nay.
Yay.
The ayes have it. We close debate and we'll move to a vote on this article. Article 7, shall the voters authorize total fund expenditures for operating expenses of $1,088,700, of which $780,550 shall be raised by taxes. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say nay.
Nay.
Ayes have it. Article 7 passes.
I need some discussion.
Article 8. shall the voters appropriate $45,625 towards operating expenses of the Rochester Public Library. Someone move that for me, please. Moved and seconded. Discussion? Well, I'll lead it back. Walt?
Me again.
Hi, Walt.
I just want to make a short statement regarding the library. Those who were here last year probably recall that there was a lively discussion about the library budget last year.
Can you speak
year,
up?
Funded.
A little louder, Walt, please, if you can.
I'll try. Following town meeting last year, I attended a library trustee meeting to inquire about their endowment funds and the spending policy regarding those funds. That's part of what goes into funding the library budget. The spending policy was quite dated and predicated on a policy agreed to with the investment firm of record. With the approval of the library trustees, an investment advisory committee was formed to review and make recommendations to the trustees on management of the endowment funds to further benefit the library in perpetuity, which is what endowment funds are supposed to. The committee included Forrest Newton, Wanda Durham, Sandy Pierce, myself, and library representatives. A review determined that the investment policy in play did not correspond with the spending policy before the funds and might result in depletion of the endowed funds within approximately 12 years, meaning that the $16,000 plus that was being put into their budget would no longer exist. A recommendation was made that spending needed to be severely reduced. It was further recommended that several investment firms be invited to make proposals of how they would manage the available funds to ensure perpetuity while stabilizing an annual spending policy. Members of the committee and the library trustees heard proposals from Northfield Savings Bank Investment Division, Community Financial Services Group, and Edward Jones. The committee reviewed these proposals and recommended to the committee, rather to the trustees, that the Northfield Savings Bank proposal best met the concerns of the committee regarding stabilizing the principal, providing growth in perpetuity, and increasing annual available funds to support library programs. Additionally, Northfield Savings would charge no transfer fees to acquire the funds from where they were, and no annual management fees to hold the money. Trustees ultimately transferred the funds to the Northfield Savings Bank for the foreseeable future. Upon recommendation of the committee, the trustees adopted a new statement of objectives regarding the library endowment funds, including a clearly stated spending equation, which will keep these funds into the future. So personally, I'd like to thank the committee members and commend the library trustees for stepping forward and looking at their funds and then moving their funds in a way that will keep them in perpetuity.
Any further discussion?
Yes, I think there's some.
I'm just curious. I can't really understand the library budget, the way it's set up. It's a little cumbersome for me. I do bookkeeping for the town of Rochester. And I had a discussion with a trustee of the library at the beginning of the fiscal year, right after the end of the fiscal year, where the library checking account had about $8,300 in it. That's unrestricted money. Wondering if that $8,300 is being used to offset any of the expenses. Just curious.
Any other trustees want to address that?
If it's defined as a restricted, it can only be spent on special expenses, restricted. Like if we have a restricted fund for books, they can only go into books. So I believe that's the case. We cannot move it to any other, we cannot pay anything else. Let's say, electricity with that, with restricted funds.
You follow up, Becky?
I can answer that.
This money was in your checking account, it's an unrestricted checking account. Your restricted money flows from your restricted accounts through the checking account to pay restricted expenses like memorial books or I think maybe adopt an author or whatever. I'm just curious to know if you did use that money. Maybe the horses got out of the barn, maybe next year you can take a look to see, maybe you could offset the $45,000 that you're asking the town for. You had no liabilities at the end of the fiscal year. All your liabilities were paid, so I expect your restricted expenses were paid. But I don't know, I'm just a bean counter.
Well, unfortunately our treasurer is not here.
Oh.
Barbara is.
Oh, Barbara.
So,
okay.
Yeah, she works closely with our Jeanette.
Okay.
So she,
I'm just curious.
Sure she'll clarify. But non-restricted, we spend on like bills and stuff like that. So it's, I'm sure that's going to be used, right? I don't do the books.
Becky, I think the biggest use of that money, as Walt referred to, we had been drawing $8,700 a year out of our Kirk Endowment Fund, which was an unsustainable amount of money, which with the new policy has been reduced to $3,300 a year. So right there is over $5,000 of reduced income that will go to pay for the year.
Any further discussion? I'll hand it back to Harlan.
Just like to say that as far as the bang for your buck, you're doing really good with the library.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I'm not disputing that the library is doing well. I think that they are meticulous. Every month, they go through their balance sheets, their budget reports. They'll correct me if I've classified something wrong. They're very meticulous. I'm just concerned about the $8,300. Last year was a $6,500 balance left in the checking account with no accounts payable, no liabilities ahead. So I would very much appreciate it if next year, when you start working on the budget, take a look at your unrestricted balance in that checking account, your operating checking account. Yes. Of course, Cindy.
I
was just wondering, does the library have a reserve fund?
No, we don't.
Does the library have a reserve fund, is the question?
No, we don't. We asked for it a couple of times,
okay,
but
well,
we don't want it.
Is the reserve fund.
Years ago, but no. Not anymore.
No. Go ahead, Jeanette.
But we may have money left in the checking account on June 30th, but we don't get in our income from the town or from other sources right away. So we go a month or two without that input. So we have to be able to pay the bills that come in July and come in August from something. And so having some money in the checking account, June 30th pays those July and August bills.
Someone who hasn't spoken yet, Becky, go ahead.
I just wanted to just say what an amazing library we have, and I just think it's just a fabulous resource for the town, and I couldn't be more pleased to have it here. So thank you, Jim, and everybody.
Call the question.
You may be recognized and then call the questions. After a couple of times people are calling it out, just be recognized first. But Diane?
Call the question.
Excellent. Questions be called with a two-thirds vote. We'll end discussion. All in favor of ending discussion, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say nay. We move to a vote on Article 8. Shall the voters appropriate $45,625 towards operating expenses of the public Rochester Public Library? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say nay. Ayes have it. Article 8 passes. Article 9. Article 9, shall voters appropriate $68,340 to provide ambulance service from White River Valley Ambulance. Someone move that?
So moved.
Ethan, move it. Second. Someone, thank you. Discussion. Yes, Nancy.
Nick Roboto is not able to be here tonight, and he just asked me to share a few comments with you and refer you to the WERVA budget summary and comments on page 44 in the town report. WERVA is requesting a reduction per capita from $63 to $60, made possible by a slight increase in expected inter-hospital transfers and tight control on expenses, including moving the health insurance plan from Blue Cross to MVP. And additionally, WERVA received about 100 calls from Rochester in 2019.
Further discussion? Seeing none, we'll move to a vote on Article 9. Shall the voters appropriate $68,340 to provide ambulance service from White River Valley Ambulance? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say nay. Ayes have it. Article 9 passes. Article 10. Shall the voters vote to appropriate $20,400, $1,700 per month, to continue funding the Fast Trash and Recycling Program, receipt of recyclables and trash with residents paying for trash per bag, from July 1, 2020 through June 30, 2021.
So moved.
Moved by David.
Second.
Seconded. Discussion. Being none, we'll move to a vote.
I'll say something.
All right.
This is, we separated this out as a separate vote because this was one of the items on the budget that had a significant increase, so we thought we'd share that with y'all to make the decision instead of just, that was one of the pressures on the budget this year.
John.
Hello.
John, could you stand, please?
Okay. Sorry. I don't use the program, so I'm not that familiar with it. Being we're paying per bag, what are we paying for with the additional, was it $20,000? Here.
The recycling. Yeah, that was how it initially started out as the recycling offering, and then they, when Able Waste took it over, they offered the pay per bag service also.
Do you have any idea of the what we're getting for $20,000? That's a fair amount of money. I mean, if we're collecting only a bit of recycle.
Well, it's basically it's their service twice a month to be present there.
It's a lot of recycling. Okay.
Judy, did you?
Not answered.
Okay. Yeah.
I wanted to say I use it as do many people in town, and not only do I use it for recycling and for trash, but I also use the compost service that they have now. And composting is becoming, I believe it's this summer that it becomes a state law. And I found that's really helpful. I understand it is has gone up some, but I found that they've done a good job, so that's just my opinion. I really appreciate the three services that they provide with the composting, the recycling, and trash.
Ethan, and you're on.
Yes, Ethan Bowen.
just curious, and my memory may be faulty, but I remember it used to maybe be once a month?
Yeah.
And is there a savings there, and is that a possibility?
Good question. I don't know. It became twice a month when Able Waste took it over from Benson's.
Yeah.
There were also times when it filled up.
Yeah.
The volume was too much.
Yeah, the volume was pretty extreme for a month.
I remember
they used
that.
To
thank you.
Have to drop a second container the night before, and it was a lot. Yeah.
I remember that. Thank you.
Yolanda,
I just wanted to also mention that it's also a great source of fundraising. Organizations like PTO and church and different classes, grades at elementary school now have been very successful in raising money for their trips or, you know, like teachers' days and all kinds of events.
Could you speak to how much of the recycling is actually being recycled?
Good question. I brought this up at the meeting. That is, your guess is as good as mine. I fear that there's pressures for it to be less and less, but they assure us that they take it to a facility that is still processing it as recycling. But you know, once it's in the truck and it heads down the road, who knows?
Mr. Bushnell, yes.
One last thing. I think we can all agree there's nothing more important than cleaning up our own mess. Having grown up in Vermont, I know that 50 years ago, the Connecticut River was so badly. When I grew up here, 50 years ago, the Connecticut River was so polluted, you couldn't do anything with it. And now it's a class A-minus river. All of this happened because of recycling, because of people doing the right thing. It costs more money, it's a pain in the neck, but you know, long term, we would be up to our knees in styrofoam cups and crap if we didn't do something about it. So I agree completely with it, whatever it costs.
If I may, second time, Ethan. Do it. I totally support it too, and use the service. But shouldn't we know that we're getting what we pay for?
Part of why
yes.
this discussion's taking
That's
place.
Why we're having this discussion, and have you know to have talked with them, and like I said, they've assured me that they are taking it to the proper facility. But I have not driven behind the truck myself to see where it goes. Yeah. We're looking for volunteers.
Yes.
Yes.
Field
trip.
Sorry.
I'm Irene Smead, and I've been looking for compostable trash bags. And I noticed that both our retailers or whatever, or storefronts in Rochester don't have big trash bags that are compostable, but they do have the smaller ones for actual food scraps. So let's urge our local businesses to buy compostable bags so that, you know, when you do take your trash to the landfill, it's going to break down faster than it is now in these bags that take years and years and years to decompose. So that's just a suggestion.
I believe that is part of what Able Waste is providing. They sell them.
Yes.
But
for $4, if you go, may I say?
Yeah,
I'm sorry. What's happened with me is I have a 5-gallon plastic bucket, and when I go there, the bag they give me is a green compostable bag. I pay $4 for the bag, and it takes me like a month and a half to fill it up.
But that's for food scrap?
For food scrap.
But I'm talking about the garbage. There's so many people in town have Airbnbs now, and I help a few people close up their Airbnbs, and the trash is just unbelievable. So all these, you know, bags that don't decompose are going to our landfills. Anyway, that's just my suggestion. I haven't found complete answer myself to buying bags that are not going to be there 150 years from now. So anyway, if anyone has any thoughts, I'd be on the committee to find the supplier and provide them for town people to buy.
David.
The
yeah, but it would help if you could stand and face the group.
The state has slowly been taking out of the waste stream all of the things that do break down. So the idea that a trash bag containing non-biodegradable plastics and metal and mixed materials, the idea that the bag breaks down and makes the stuff in it break down further is not the case. The stuff that's in the bag doesn't break down at all. The stuff that goes to the landfill, the stuff that won't break down, you're taking out paper, it breaks down. You're putting it in a single stream recycling stream, which includes now all the other things that do break down, and hopefully they're being separated by XCOM somewhere, and glass is going in one place, and the cardboard is going in another place, and the big plastic jugs are being made into little plastic jugs, maybe. But the trash bags, for real trash, they don't need to break down. They're going to be buried with all the other stuff that doesn't break down. In Coventry, we think. Right on the shores of Lake Nymphomega.
Chris?
Can I call a question,
please? Yes, you may, sir. Chris, as we call it, all in favor of any debate, say aye.
Aye.
As opposed, say nay. I accept that. And we'll move to a vote on Article 10. Shall the voters vote to appropriate $20,400, that's $1,700 per month, to continue funding the fast trash and recycling program, receipt of recyclables and trash, with residents paying for trash per bag from July 1, 2020 through June 30, 2021. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say nay.
Thank you.
Ayes have it. Article 10 passes. Article 11, shall the voters vote to eliminate the Cruiser Reserve Fund and transfer the remaining balance, $2,794.31, plus any additional interest, to the General Fund for the purpose of offsetting the Windsor County Sheriff's contract?
So moved.
Moved, thank you, Everett.
Second.
Seconded, Judy, thank you. Discussion?
Sounds like a good idea.
One good idea. John?
Don't keep up with things. Have we lost our constable?
No, he's sitting in the back corner there. Yeah. But we've lost a constable with law enforcement status. And we have made the shift to contracting out with the Windsor County Sheriff. And now, so then, therefore, we have no need of the Cruiser Reserve Fund, because we're not going to buy another cruiser.
Mike,
there
I just some clarification here. It says $2,794.31, but in the reserve funds, it says $2,795.34. It's a few pennies, but I don't know. I'm going to leave this reserve fund open.
Probably a difference between interest.
That could be just the difference of the interest that is accumulated. But no, there's no desire to keep the reserve fund open. That's what the article here is to do, is to close it and use that fund.
Yes, Rob.
My question is just from the select board, I guess. Are you comfortable with the coverage that we're getting from the sheriff's department compared to the coverage we're getting in terms of the police keeping in the town, we're getting from the constable?
We're comfortable. I'll speak for these other two. I think we're comfortable, and I believe we're actually getting a more robust coverage than we were in the past. Yeah.
Ethan?
Did we sell the cruiser?
We did. And we have used some of that, we used that money to offset some of the expenses for some fire department equipment and such to, again, to whittle the budget down.
And the office supplies.
Yeah.
Catherine?
I was at that pre-team, the pre-meeting meeting on Monday night, and Evelyn Brooksma expressed her concerns about no longer having a fund for the tennis courts, and the value of the tennis court being around $100,000 and the need for repairs. to that recreation facility, and I know that there is a broad contingency of the town that sees Rochester as a recreation destination. Bike trails, Rasta, it's all really wonderful. And I wondered why we wouldn't take that balance and put it into the tennis courts at this point, because they aren't funded. Their line item is not on the article. So I just wondered if that was a possibility rather than putting it in the general fund, because I assume the sheriff is raising money with tickets. We don't need to offset what he's doing. He's earning his way, right? By keeping us all... Right, we're paying the sheriffs, but he's bringing in revenue, right?
Right, but he's not totally paying his own way. There is still an expense with it. So we just figured that was a logical application of that, because the money had been already allocated for law enforcement purposes, so we figured that was a logical way to...
So you say offset, but really what you mean, the cost of it is more than what we're bringing in revenues for law enforcement?
Yes. Yes.
Larry. I'd like to propose an amendment to Article 11. I'd like to propose that we delete all the wording within the parentheses and put a period at the end of the word general fund and eliminate all the wording following general fund. So the article would read, shall the voters vote to eliminate the cruiser reserve fund and transfer the remaining balance to the general fund?
Period. I second that.
And it has been seconded. So we have an amendment on the table that would eliminate part of that, the part that says for the purpose of offsetting the Windsor County Sheriff's contracts. Any discussion on that amendment?
Could Larry please explain why he wants that amendment?
Yeah, so there's the question of whether the dollar amount is correct, and so we would be forced to only eliminate this amount, and we could be stuck with a cruiser fund that has pennies in it, because that's what we've told authorized them to do. And there's no reason to direct where this money goes. It could be, all monies that are voted in the budget are spent at the discretion of the select board. All monies. Just because it's a budget line in the proposed budget, it's not actually prescribed that that's how it's spent. So just return this money to the general fund and let the select board make the correct decision on how to spend it, as they do for our funds.
Larry, clarification, were you also was the amendment to eliminate that parenthetical there, so there's no amount?
The entire parenthetical.
Yeah.
Yep. Any other discussion? An amendment. So we'll vote on the amendment. So we have an amendment to Article 11, and it eliminates the parenthetical there with the dollar amount and the additional interest. And from the end of it, where it says for the purpose of offsetting Windsor County Sheriff's contract, and the amended article would read, shall the voters vote to eliminate the cruiser reserve fund and transfer the remaining balance to the general fund. Period. All in favor of that amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say nay. So the article's been amended, and then we vote on it again. We'll discuss it again. Is there more discussion now on the amended article? Ethan?
I move the question.
Question's been called. All in favor of any debate on this amended article, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say nay. Ayes have it. End debate. As amended, we'll vote on Article 11. Shall the voters vote to eliminate the Cruiser Reserve Fund and transfer the remaining balance to the General Fund? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say nay. Ayes have it. And Article 11 passes as amended. So you get that, Julie, how that was worded?
I
Article 12, shall the voters vote to exempt Pierce Hall Community Center, a 501(c)(3) nonprofit organization, from their property taxes for a five-year period, 2020 to 2025, fiscal years 21 to fiscal year 25. Move that. Seconded. Moved and seconded. Kelly. Discussion? Robert?
Does anyone know what the tax implications of that is? We have a figure on that?
They haven't paid taxes.
They haven't paid taxes.
It's never even been assessed.
Anybody know?
There would be a...
What would be the value of that thing?
Say it has the taxes.
I'm sure they do, but it's seven grand less than that. It's not that good. Sorry.
Sorry. Any other discussion?
Dan?
No, no, yes.
Dan?
Yes.
Oh, okay, all right. Go ahead.
Hi.
Bruce?
Could I refer to my notes?
Yes.
No objections? You can read from your notes. Thank you for asking.
I'm Bruce Llewellyn. I'm on the board of directors of Pierce Hall Community Center, and I've been a board member since 2007. And first of all, we'd like to thank the voters for exempting Pierce Hall, the building, from the property taxes. And you've done that for the last 16 years. This is not a new request. Just every 5 years, we have to come back to the voters and ask for that exemption once again. The board of directors manages the operation of Pierce Hall. And we're all volunteers. There are no paid salaries in the operation of Pierce Hall. We spend countless hours of volunteers every year. Hundreds of hours, if not over 1,000 hours. And we do all of the operation there. It's everything from managing rentals to cleaning windows to mowing the lawn or shoveling snow. We're a working board of directors. And we put in lots and lots of hours to keep that building up and running. You last voted the exemption in 2015. We've made some major progress, and I'd just like to highlight some of those items. So in 2015, we finished installing lower level windows. The Department of Historic Preservation allowed us to replace those windows because they were in such bad shape. So now we have new energy efficient windows throughout the basement. We also finished constructing the accessible restrooms that are down in the lower level, and they're fully accessible to people with disabilities. So then in 2016, we celebrated the 100th anniversary of Pierce Hall. And in order to get ready for that wonderful celebration, we concentrated on cosmetic items, mostly in the auditorium, painting walls, painting the ceiling that had 100 years of coal smoke and cigar smoke and smoke, and it made a tremendous difference. It really brightened up that whole auditorium. We also upgraded or restored the under the balcony lights, the historic lights. We also restored the beautiful chandelier that's in the center of the ceiling there. That had been laying on two sawhorses up on the back of the stage there, and that was restored and put back to where it now is. In 2017, the big project was to restore the whole front entrance, tear down the old porte-cochere, redo the steps, and rebuild the whole thing. And that was quite a project. And we had the governor here to cut the ribbon when that was opened up. For 2019, after several years of planning, what started out as Michael Crickard Senior Project became a reality this past July when we opened the Pierce Hall Community Fitness Center. And we underestimated how popular that fitness center is. It's tremendous. I hope somebody here that uses it will speak up about it. But we average over 10 people a day into that, the gym and the rest of the fitness center. So our feeling is that Pierce Hall is a real asset for the town of Rochester, really for the whole valley. We encompass the five towns in the Upper White River Valley. And we think it's an important asset and one that will become even more important now that the high school is closed. We don't know if we'll be meeting here next year at this time. Maybe we'll be back in Pierce Hall like it was for years and years and years. The town meetings were held in Pierce Hall. So we hope you see it that way too, and we urge you to vote to pass this article. Thank you.
Further discussion, Nancy.
My name is Nancy, I live on Sons. Can you hear me back there?
No.
My name is Nancy Esteban Sanz, and I am a member of the Pierce Hall Board of Directors. My present title is a Vice President of Programs and PR, and I urge you to approve this tax abatement. And on behalf of the board, I also thank you for past approvals of this tax abatement. It's helped us tremendously to become a success. Another person that I'd like to acknowledge is Dr. Val, who passed away this past year, and she was a tremendous leader for us. She devised a plan where she broke the whole project, which was tremendous, into five different phases, and we went ahead and we would tackle a phase, complete it, pay for it, go on to the next phase. We're almost done. We have some things to do still, but when we finish, there won't be any debt incurred for the restoration of Pierce Hall. This is my 20th year serving on the project. Our first 2 years, we were a steering committee, and then we formed into a board of directors. We incorporated, became a nonprofit, tax-exempt organization. So I strongly urge you to please approve again of our tax abatement.
Mr. Moderator, just a question to the Pierce Hall Committee. What events, I believe there are some, do you donate the space of the use of Pierce Hall to the community? I believe Starry
yes.
Night.
We hold a Halloween party that's tremendously yep. popular mm-hmm. and at no cost to the community or anyone attending. We also have Starry Night, which is a program that I organize where I bring the children, I organize it with the school to bring the children to Pierce Hall to sing at the beginning of December, and the children just love it. And we also have we have a little ballet class that we do every year, which is minimal expense to the parents, only like $8 a class. And at other times, we might do other things that are for the community.
Okay, you'll learn then, Joe.
Bruce has asked that we talk maybe about the fitness center, and I don't use it yet, but I haven't used it. But my children have, and our youngest son, who is just left the nest, you know, he's in college. When he comes home, that's what he does, you know. He just goes to gym, and actually he got, that was the best present for him to get him a membership. Because it's, you know, like, unfortunately, as we know, there's less and less young kids in our town. So when they do come from on college breaks or, you know, to visit their old parents, you know, we want them to be around. So instead of Daniel used to go to Randolph, he's very you know, most young people, they is into working out and stuff. So he used to go to Randolph to VTC. Now he goes to, you know, Pierce Hall to work out, and he's very happy about it. So I hope, you know, this will stay popular with our young people, and not only young people. I want to start working out there too.
So, did you have something?
Yeah, I couldn't hear everything Nancy said from back here, but I just want to acknowledge that there's also the site of the rain site for the entertainment events, the park concerts, and we have gone there several times, so I thank you for that.
I would have something.
Kevin?
I just want to underscore what Bruce said about the volunteers. Every event, and I've been to many events at Pierce Hall, there's always a board volunteer there. They're committed totally from the beginning of the event to the end of the event, and including the fitness center nights, they are there. So these are unpaid people who make this facility work, and I'm really interested to know what the next phase is going to be.
Martha.
Can I call the question?
Certainly. Questions? We called all in favor of ending debate. Say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say nay. We'll move to a vote on Article 12. Shall the voters vote to exempt Pierce Hall Community Center, a 501c3 nonprofit organization, from property taxes for the five-year period 2020 to 2025, fiscal years 21 to fiscal year 25? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say nay. Ayes have it. Article 13. To see if the voters will vote to appropriate the following sums as requested by the below listed community agencies. Central Vermont Council on the Aging, $3,000. Clare Martin Center, $2,066. Greenup Vermont, $100. Quintown Senior Center, $9,849. Orange County Parent Child Center, $250. Safeline Incorporated, $250. Stagecoach, $1,300. Vermont Rural Fire Hydrant, $100. VNH, Visiting Nurse Association, $4,800. White River Partnership, $875. Women Safe, $250. For a total of $22,840.
So moved.
Moved. Here, and then?
Second.
Discussion.
These are all worthwhile community things that help different people in our community, and I think we should fund them.
You're here.
You're here.
Yeah.
Call a question.
Questions been called. All in favor of closing debate, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say nay. Debate is closed. We'll move to a vote on Article 13. See if the voters will vote to appropriate the following sums requested by the below listed community agencies. If there are no objections, I won't read through the whole list again. For a total of $22,840. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say nay. Ayes have it. Article 13 passes. Article 14. Article 14, the town of Rochester adopt the below climate emergency declaration to inform and guide town decision making. Whereas global climate is changing at an unprecedented rate due to human activities, driving mass extinction of species and threatening human communities worldwide. Whereas the United Nations Panel on Climate Change reported in 2018 that we need a drastic reduction in greenhouse gas emissions by 2030 to avoid catastrophic global warming. Whereas residents of the town of Rochester have suffered significant losses due to increasingly frequent extreme weather events, and that action is required to promote greater resilience. Now be it therefore resolved, the town of Rochester declares that a climate emergency threatens our town, state, region, and entire natural world. And be it further resolved, the town of Rochester trusts Rochester will make climate change an integral focus for town planning, policy, and decision making, and will work towards a more renewable economy for a more resilient community.
So moved. Okay.
Moved. Seconded. Carrie. Discussion. Catherine. Then Nancy.
I applaud the fact that we're including
this climate action in our town policy if we vote to do so. But I would add some language just in consideration of town resources to add the additional language at the end, to the greatest extent possible according to the resources available to the town. Because we'll do our best, but we have to recognize too that we can only do what we can do. And I also thank Lizzie Shackleton and her group for taking this mission.
So, Catherine, you're proposing an amendment to the article with that?
I am.
Okay. To the greatest extent possible,
according to the resources available to the town.
And that's the very last part under more resilient community?
That would be in the very last part.
Okay.
Okay. And a second for that? That has been seconded. Discussion on that? Rachel, then Larry, then Sydney, and then.
Yeah, Lizzie's last name is actually Shackleford. And I'd like to make a second amendment. I'd like to add on to that.
Hang on a second, you've got to check with my parliamentarians. Can we amend the amendment?
First amendment has to be seconded through the process, voted on. Then you can take a second.
No, you can amend that amendment once.
Oh, if she's amending the amendment.
You're amending the amendment?
Yes.
Ah, very good.
Okay, so we're on the amendment right now, which is what Catherine threw out there with adding that sentence to the back. So that's what we're discussing. So you can amend it as Catherine amended it.
Yes, I like exactly her verbiage. I'd like to add a comma and the next phrase, and in accordance to Vermont law. Because there is some laws that are being developed right now at State Assembly.
According to resources available to the town and...
comma, and in accordance with Vermont law. Period. Thank you.
Okay, can I get a second on that? Amendment to the amendment. Seconded. We'll discuss it. So I'm not going to read the entire thing. I'm going to read the last paragraph if there are no objections. Do you have a point of order, Cindy, or what?
I wanted to say one thing. Adding an amendment to the amendment.
Okay, I can't do that yet. We have to dispose of this amendment to the amendment, and then we can pick up another amendment to the amendment if we want. So if there are no objections, I'm just going to read the last paragraph. Be it further resolved, the town of Rochester will make climate change an integral focus of town planning, policy, and decision making, and will work towards a more renewable economy for a more resilient community to the greatest extent possible according to resources available to the town in accordance with Vermont law. Let me read that again.
Please.
Okay. Be it further resolved, the town of Rochester will make climate change an integral focus for town planning, policy, and decision-making, and will work towards a more renewable economy for a more resilient community to the greatest extent possible, according to resources available to the town in accordance with Vermont law. Okay, discussion? Cindy, did you have a comment? You can't amend it yet, but if you have a comment.
I have a question.
Okay.
A lot of this is theoretical.
Please stand up.
We can't hear you real well. A lot of this is theoretical,
and I was just wondering, does this mean that we're going to assign a climate change committee to, is it actually going to be a committee that could be?
I do not read it as such, if I'm reading the wording, but anyone else?
That was not the plan.
That was not the plan
of the original thing, was merely to have you consider these issues, to consider it when you make a decision before you do something, rather than just make a decision without arbitrarily looking at anything. That was the whole idea of this cause, was not to necessarily change what you do, but rather to make you think before you act, and that was the total focus of this. rather than actually involve a whole lot of changes, but rather just to have the town people consider our environment before they go ahead and do something.
I remind folks, please raise your hand to recognize and don't shout out. Larry? So
we're bogged down now in multiple amendments. If what I would like to suggest here is that I think what's giving people pause about the way this was originally drafted, or at least let me just say what's giving me pause, is exactly, I think, the sense I'm getting is the concern about how the language as originally drafted would impact actual day-to-day decision-making of the Select Board and force them to do what or not do what and be questioned every time they make any and every decision. And so I get that that was perhaps the sense of what Catherine was trying to correct by her amendment. But now we're bogged down in this amendment.
I'm not saying it's bogged down. We're discussing this amendment as I read it.
But we can't keep amending. I had intended to try to amend out the references to the decision making, but you know I don't know, you know, so how to do it at this
point. At this point, we're gonna dispose of, that's not a great word, but we're going to deal with the amendments that Rachel put onto Catherine's amendment, and then we'll, if that passes, we'll look at the whole thing as amended twice, and then we'll discuss Catherine's amendment as amended if that passes. And then if none of those pass, Larry, we'll come back to you with amendment number 3. So we're in discussion of the amended amendments. Who's in track? I think Bill and then Barbara and then...
So Dan, can somebody address if the state is actually going to put something into law and we're voting on accepting it right now? Can somebody talk to that?
Sally?
She's getting up.
Yeah, go for it.
Can it?
The legislation that is pending right now deals with having a plan at the state level and having state departments work together to work it into state planning. It does not, would not, there is no, I don't foresee any mandate for the town, certainly not within the next couple of years, and it would probably come back to the legislature before it turned into anything like that, but I don't foresee that at all. So I don't see that that's an issue to worry about tonight.
Thank you.
Barbara?
I guess it's a question of interpretation. Is this a suggestion or a very strong mandate? How much latitude does the board have? One thing to say the suggestion is, another thing to say we must. I'm not clear about how
the wording says will. Can anyone answer for Barbara's question?
Are we still on the amendment to the...
Yes, we're still on the amendment to the amendment.
Because I can speak on some other things, but not the amendment.
Okay. So I had Ethan, and then Mr. Bushner, and then
No, I guess as well. And maybe this is to say that the amendments aren't necessary, because I think that for me the key word is integral focus for town planning, is that we will make climate change an integral focus, which does not mean, you know, you have to. It's, and I think that what this is a great statement, particularly this last paragraph, is that when those of us who do go to a select board meeting, you can look at this and say, well, what's the focus here? Are you focusing? You know, we can ask that question. And I think it makes it very clear that we're going to ask that question. We're going to focus on climate change issues in the planning of town budget and in how the town is managed. So I don't believe we need the extra language. I believe it's covered in the language that's already there.
And
I agree with that completely, and I'd like to add that, as I understand from speaking to somebody here earlier tonight, that Marion Leonard brought the same issue up 15 years or so ago, and it was voted on and passed, that we would do exactly the same thing. But unfortunately, in the last 15 years or so, there's been a loss of focus on people, and we're just trying to bring your attention back to the idea that, as Ethan said, we are going to focus on something rather than just generally accepting whatever's put in front of us.
Karen?
I was the one who mentioned that to Mr. Bushnell earlier. Shortly after we moved here 18 years ago, I think it might have been 16 years ago, we all voted as a town to have the select board make all of their decisions with earth in mind, or the earth in mind. And the discussion went around the fact that we would need to be addressing environmental problems in the select board. Hopefully that's been happening. I think generally speaking, that is something that goes on. I think this really codifies it a little bit more. And I agree completely with Ethan about the key term being focus. It's not a mandate, like you have to spend this extra amount of money because of this. It's just, this is an integral focus. It's not a requirement, but it's a strongly worded article for our current crisis. So I agree that I don't think we need the amendment because I think it stands as is. But I just wanted to also clarify that with earth in mind.
Okay, Irene, David, and then Arne.
Well, I just want to say that this is not unique to Rochester. You probably all know that. You're probably seeing it in the news. I think what it's doing for us as a community is it's bringing up a subject that we all want to talk about. I want to just recognize how this community pulled together during Hurricane Irene. I didn't live here then. I lived in South Royalton, and I couldn't even get here for months and months. Well, I just want to say that was an issue that smacked me to wake up and say, you know, Vermont is the safest place I've ever lived, and yet we have a weather event that changed so many people's lives. Like other places around the world, we are now in a more vulnerable situation because of our climate. And so I think this is what we did when we first started talking about this that brought this to the town agenda was, okay, all around the world, communities are doing this, and we're safe and we're protected in Vermont, and we have green everywhere around us still. We want to keep it that way, and we want to follow this global movement and put it into our town plan that we've made a statement that we want to follow this path to save our environment for our grandchildren. So that's where it came from. It's not unique. Lizzie didn't really write it all by herself, neither did any of us. The UK started with something like this years ago, and it's taken hold. People are doing it everywhere.
The article is aspirational. The amendments, both of them, are aspirational. They don't require the town to do or not do anything. But as evidence for why we need to pass something like this, when the trustees of public funds were asked to take money out of oil companies and put them into something more environmentally politically correct, we were told by the trustees of public funds they're not allowed to think about that. They are required to make the most money for the town with these funds that they can. And so, shut up. And I think they should think about that.
I just want to say that I think it's time that we stop basing our reaction to climate control, you know, and on a dollar. You know, it's time we start doing something. The more we keep putting this off, the more it's going to cost us down the road. It's already costing us billions and billions and billions every year in flooding and everything else. I mean, when are people going to wake up and get the message? If we don't start doing something now, it's going to cost. It's going to cost either way, but it's going to cost more down the road.
Brenda?
Hello.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Forgot about me.
Oh.
I think that if you look at this article, it says the town of Rochester. It doesn't say the selectmen of Rochester. It says the town of Rochester, and that's us. And I think it's important that we all stand up and recognize that something's happening in our world, and we need to recognize it sooner. Yeah. This declaration came about through the Climate Change Committee that has newly been formed. You're all invited to join us. Most of us, the chairperson is Elizabeth Shackelford. We refer to her as Lizzie. And she spent many hours researching the declarations that have been put out by different towns as well as other governments in the world. And she came up with this declaration for us that does not mandate anything to be done. It does not incur any expense. What it does is provides for the consideration to the climate of any planning or decisions that we need to make. And I personally feel that, Lizzie regretted not being here tonight. She was unavoidable for her, and she asked me to put in a few words. And we regret that she isn't here because she would do a great job. Since most of us that have joined the committee, and most of us, period, do not know that much about climate change, our committee is, our objectives are to research and learn about climate change, to pass on that information to others, also to make sure that we learn things that we can do individually to not make our climate worse and try to make it better. And also, one of our objectives is to inform our government officials of concerns we have of decisions that are made that affect the climate change. For me, my moment of waking up was when I learned that besides seeing the catastrophes on television and having experienced things that we have experienced right here in our valley, when I learned that the scientists that had made predictions of how fast the rate of climate change would be, they were very surprised to see that the rate has accelerated at a much higher pace. And when I heard that, that even surprised them. And when I heard that, I felt like I had to wake up and do something. So I've joined the Climate Change Committee, and I urge you to, I have a sign-up sheet in the lobby there that you can sign up and get information and know when our next meeting will be, and try to do something toward bettering our climate rather than making it worse. So I urge you to pass this declaration, this article, with this climate emergency declaration for the good of our grandchildren, our future generations, our country, our planet. So please do so.
I think if the board, I haven't heard what they feel about the wording, but I think the wording as stands is fine. I think we could move forward on this.
Yes. Let's move before. Wait, recognize before we call the question. We have Jeff, and then we have Ethan, and then if someone is going to call the question, can you raise your hand?
He asked a question, and he didn't get.
Yeah. Select Board was asked a question.
Yes. So the I agree that this is a very significant challenge that's facing the globe, and we're part of the globe, and we have to address it as part of the board in terms of taking care of the business with the town. It concerned me when the phrase integral focus, I would prefer to have it be consideration in talking about not requiring the town to do anything. Right on the handout, it says, take action, consider energy consumption impact in purchasing new equipment, building new facilities, bidding town contracts, how our town office runs. So I'm concerned that in this age of being sued quite a lot, that we don't set ourselves up for friction on every day-to-day decision that we make in the town. So I would I'm not making an amendment because there's already an amendment out there. But that's my feeling, is that I think that the word integral is means essential. And yes, it's essential that we face this. I'm just concerned that we don't unnecessarily bog down the town's business in putting restrictions and more of an inspiration than a restriction. So that's my thought. Do you have anything to say?
I agree with it totally. I agree.
Tom?
I would agree with Dune. I think there's
not here.
Eat the mic.
I think that there's some liability here. It's concerning. And so I agree with Dune. I think it's a little overreaching, and we need to be very careful that we're not going to be hurting Rochester residents under the guise of environmentalism. I think we have to be very careful about this.
Okay, Jeff Kipper.
I support Article 15 as it's written. I think the amendment
is 14.
14 as it's written.
It's 15.
15's okay. And I think that the amendments that proposed are well-meaning, but I think unnecessary. Our legislature really needs to hear from the communities of Vermont that they need to get serious in Montpelier, and we need to do just the same. Integral focus to me means that as the town makes decisions, it considers what can be done to reduce carbon emissions in this state and position our town for survival in the future. We're already seeing the economics on renewable energy dropping to the point where fossil fuel projects are being scrubbed because they are no longer good investments. What are we going to do in this community when we're heating with oil, with propane, in the housing that we own, when that fuel that we've been using is no longer available to us? We've got to get on the stick and start planning for it. So I support the Article 14 as written, and I'm happy to work with the Energy Committee in reviewing these as part of the regular procedure in making town decisions. I think that's what Interpol focuses on. Thank you.
I'll come back to you for a second time. Back, is that it?
Yeah. I appreciate everything that's been said here, and I certainly am concerned about the climate as much as anybody in this room. But I think I like the amendments, and I approve of them because I feel like we elected our select board, and they have the reality of the constraints of their budget. And just like when I go to the grocery store, I have to pick and choose what organic items I'm going to purchase. And they can't be all, because I can't afford to fill my grocery bag full of all organic items. So we pick and choose. And I feel like with the amendments, it offers a lacing of protection for the select board as far as others coming back to them and saying, well, you know, why didn't you do this or why didn't you do that? Because I feel like we have given them the power to decide in many ways of how to make these decisions, and we do have to trust them. And I think it's pretty clear how we all feel about these items now. And to keep that in mind, and but just a bit of best word I can think of is protection for it, as far as for the select board, for the backlash that may come their way, for making a particular decision that somebody may feel affronted by. Anyway, so I like the amendments.
Andy and another gentleman in the back of the mirror.
I represent the town of Rochester.
Hey, can you stand up?
I represent the town of Rochester on the Two Rivers Planning Board and attend a lot of meetings. And there, over the Christmas period, there was a really terrific presentation about state mandates that are coming to us at some point. So by 2050, we will be required to make significant changes. And those initiatives are coming from the state, so we'll have very concrete things to work on. So whether it's about how we recycle, how we use energy, specifically electric cars, they would like us to move from, I think we're just slightly under 3,000 electric cars on the road, they would like us to be more like 90,000 electric cars by 2050. They're thinking about insulation and weatherizing more appropriately. There's a lot of different things that we can do that will be very practical, that will make sense to you. This is very loose. I think it's really a gesture that we all get on the same page about climate change, and I think that's appropriate, and it's a good ambition. I think what is being expressed here is that we have to remember that we're a tiny town with a tiny budget, and we don't want to hamstring our community and get us wrapped up into things that we can't actually affect. But there are concrete things that we can be doing, and they will take time to budget for. So being aware of what those things can be is our responsibility, and the community can figure out a way to absorb some of these suggestions. So the state is planning, and those mandates will come down, and we will have an opportunity to debate those things. I think it's just sort of being open and recognizing that this is very ambitious, and it will require a tremendous amount of effort from the community to address. So I think I really liked an awful lot what was said here by Brenda, that it is the town of Rochester and not just the select board. It's a three-person select board, and I can tell you that they do everything they can to do the town's business as efficiently as they can, as does the budget and finance committee, as does planning. But it is a volunteer position, as we all know. More volunteers will be needed.
Point of order.
Yeah.
Technically, we are only supposed to be talking about the amendment in this discussion time. So which amendment is in front of us right now? That's the technical, just so we know. We are a lot of us are talking about the entire article. Until we get back there, we can't really talk about it.
I liked the amendment.
No, I'm just
saying. Any questions? Are you
talking about the right thing?
I got you down, though, Martha. So, point of order, where are we? So right now we are in the amendment to Catherine's amendment, which was to include in accordance with state law. That's all what we're talking about here. It's hard to not think about the whole thing, but that's what we're talking about. Should we add that piece to Catherine's amendment, which talked about to the greatest extent possible? So, in order of the hands going up, I have the gentleman in the back behind Chris, and then I have Larry Pleasant, and then Martha.
I just wanted to say that when it comes to, you know, when it comes to the environment and the climate, using resources responsibly and turning towards things, like, we're going to be reaping what we're sowing. That's, you know, that's what got us here in the first place, was farms and the introduction of industrial machinery into agriculture. That was the driving point of coal mining and many other things, along with trade. And so, in defense of where we live and, you know, the amendment and the article as it is that it goes right back to just proper waste use and, you know, keeping track of our waste, where it's going, what we're doing with it. So, yeah, it's non-binding, and if some other people are like, nope, we want open coal fires downtown all the time, burning and raging, let them come in and put forth an article and we can vote on it again too. But in the meantime, it seems more pressing to, you know, live more locally and consider it an accurate representation of every other community around the world.
Point of order?
Yes.
This was just discussed. This comments here have nothing to do with the amendment to the amendment. Can we kind of stick to things, or we're going to be here all night talking in circles?
Okay, let's try and focus on the amendment. Should we add, in accordance with state law? Larry Pleasant was next up. Okay, Martha?
I was just going to see if we could call one of the questions at least.
There's only one question to call right now.
All right. Can we? What's our next thing? We have to vote on the Second Amendment, right?
Correct.
Can we do that?
I would love to vote on the Second Amendment. So the question's been called. We're going to end discussion on the amendment of the amendment, which is about the in accordance with Vermont state law. To close, we need 2/3 vote to close discussion. All in favor of closing discussion on the amendment to the amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say nay. Okay, ayes have it. Close discussion. We'll go to a vote on the amendment to the amendment. I'm just going to read the last paragraph if there are no objections. Be it further resolved, the town of Rochester will make climate change an integral focus to town planning, policy, and decision making, and will work towards a more renewable economy for a more resilient community to the greatest extent possible according to resources available to the town. And the amendment to that was the in accordance with Vermont state law. All in favor of amending the amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say nay.
Nay.
Now let me do the voice one more time. All in favor of amending the amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed to amending the amendment, say nay.
Nay.
I'm going to go with the ayes. Have it.
No, divide the house.
Divide the house. Thank you very much. So we're going to need a show of hands, and I need, what do you guys call them? The civil board authority. Some help with counting hands. Can I get a few of you up here? We'll section it up. To count hands.
And one of you guys help maybe count this side over here?
I'll do that side.
Okay. And
so Luke, we're going to divide the house with a show of hands. Harlan, unless you have a point of order.
Well, the point of order is, don't we have to vote on the First Amendment before we can amend it?
No.
Okay.
Thank you for the question. So this is the ayes. Raise your hand for an aye that you want to amend the amendment. Amending the amendment, please raise your hand. You got that one.
You're all set.
Thanks, Kevin.
Sure.
So what's the number?
Six.
Fifty-seven yeas and 33 nays, so the amendment to the amendment passes.
And you were right, there were yeas.
Thank you, David. Can you say that a little louder? Stand up a little. All right, so we have before us an amendment that's been amended, and the article as amended, the last paragraph, they have further resolved the town of Rochester will make climate change an integral focus for town planning, policy, and decision-making, and will work towards a more renewable economy from a resilient community to the greatest extent possible, according to resources available to the town in accordance with Vermont law.
Call the question.
The question's been called.
I second.
For the amendment.
A second.
All in favor of ending discussion on the amendment, the article as amended, say aye.
Aye.
As opposed, say nay.
Yay.
Okay. Sorry, the ayes have it. Discussion is closed. We'll move to a vote on the amended article.
Amendment.
Yes, Corner Board.
We're voting on making the
second
amendment.
Voting on the, yeah, approving the amendment to the article. Yeah. Right?
The entire amendment.
Right. The entire amendment. The first.
22.
Yep. The amendment has been amended, and now we're voting on the amendment. Oh.
Right. Just the amendment one more time.
Just the amendment is to the greatest extent possible, according to resources available to the town in accordance with Vermont law. No objections, I won't read the rest of it, and we will vote on the amendment. Questions be called, we end the debate. All in favor of the amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say nay.
Nay.
Ayes have it. Article's been amended. Now we move to a discussion of the amendment.
No,
the article as amended. The article as amended.
Come on, let's do it.
Martha.
Well, I'd like to call the article because I think we've done a lot of discussion. Well,
no, Larry has
never answered my question. I'm sorry. I've had my hand up for some time.
You had, you had your hand up and you had.
And then I put it down
twice.
And let you vote, but my hand was still up.
You had talked twice and you weren't recognized, and those that hadn't spoke yet, someone called the question that hadn't spoke yet.
Right, so, and then you never came back to me.
No, because the question had been called and discussion.
Right, and I let it go.
And discussion ended.
But I want you to consider one thing before you go any further. And that's the one line in this that all of you seem to have disregarded, including the three of you people there mm-hmm. who don't seem to want to make the effort. And the line is, please consider energy. Now, the word consider means one very specific thing. It means think about it. It doesn't mean you have to do anything. And that's what I want to express to all you people. This does not require anybody in this town to do anything except to consider it, which means to think about what's happening and what we're doing. And that's all I would like to say to you, is just before you vote, would you rather have the people that represent you in your town consider things?
And thank you. Discussion has ended on this amendment. We are...
No, it hasn't.
The article as amended has been called. We haven't voted on that yet, right?
We haven't voted on it.
Right? So we're voting on ending discussion about the article that's been amended. All in favor of ending discussion, say aye.
Aye.
All those who would like to continue discussion, say nay.
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 Okay. Discussion is ended. We're moving to vote on the article as amended. If there are no objections, I won't read the entire resolution.
Actually, please read the entire.
Do it.
I think it's important.
Okay. I don't mind. Yeah. Article 14, shall the town of Rochester adopt the below climate emergency declaration to inform and guide town decision making. Whereas global climate is changing at an unprecedented rate due to human activities driving mass extinction of species and threatening human communities worldwide. Whereas the United Nations Panel on Climate Change reported in 2018 that we need a drastic reduction in greenhouse gas emissions by 2030 to avoid catastrophic global warming. Whereas residents of the town of Rochester have suffered significant losses due to increasingly frequent extreme weather events, and that action is required to promote greater resilience. Now be it therefore resolved, the town of Rochester declares that a climate emergency threatens our town, state, region, and entire natural world. And be it further resolved, the town of Rochester will make climate change an integral focus for town planning, policy, and decision-making, and will work towards a more renewable economy for a more resilient community to the greatest extent possible, according to the resources available to the town in accordance with Vermont law. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say nay. Ayes have it. Article 18 passes 500. I truly appreciate the help with points of order and amending whatever we're amending. So thank you for keeping us on track. Article 15, to transact any other legal and proper business to be brought before said meeting. Ethan.
I just want to acknowledge all the people who are involved with Brook Street, Bethel Mountain Project. And just, you know, to getting that done, getting the money for it, you know, whether it was the engineers, the policy, and just doing a really great job. And I really appreciate it. So thank you.
I would like to mention that the planning board, with the help of Two Rivers out of Queechee, has done a really thorough and good job on drafting the next version of the town plan, which they presented for a public hearing at the planning commission meeting 2 months ago, and for public comment, and now have submitted that to the select board. And now the next step is that the select board will present the town plan draft to the public for comment. And do we have a time set for that?
We don't, just when
it's coming up. Probably not the next select board meeting, but perhaps the one over. But anyway, keep attuned to the notices, and that you will have an opportunity to check out the draft of the town plan and give your input. Thank you.